Today we are reporting from the 2013 SDSU Extension Genetic Seed Stock Symposium that is held in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. I am joined today by Dr. Mike MacNeil, who is one of the speakers of our program. He is with Delta G from Miles City, Montana. Dr. MacNeil spoke on the history of beef cattle genetics. And so I have a few questions for him to tell us about what he told the producers that were in attendance at the program today. So since you talked about the history of beef cattle genetics, tell us a little bit about the history of beef cattle genetics and where it's got to us, where we are today.
So I suppose that if you're going to talk about history, you need to start from the very beginning. And that would be the domestication of cattle about 6 to 10,000 years ago. And until cattle came under the influence of man, obviously there's no opportunity for any kind of improvement program. Then taking a huge jump forward to the late 1700s, Blakewell in Great Britain was a farm manager who did some experimenting with livestock based on trial and error and operated under the principle of breeding the best to the best, much like we do today, in fact. Blakewell had very firm goals in mind as to what constituted best, and he didn't pay much attention to relationships among animals, so inbreeding was a consequence of his program. Then taking another jump forward, if you will, to the 1930s, roughly, Jay Lush and his students at Iowa State would have been the next landmark set of accomplishments that brought us to things like multiple trait selection, progeny testing, and heritability.
Well, but Dr. MacNeil, you've been involved in the genetic side of the beef industry for many years, and one of your other roles and influences you've had is working with the breed associations and the development of EPDs and the genetic tools of the EPDs. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the work that you have done with that?
Sure. I guess almost every breed association today has a set of selection indexes that they use to help breeders make multiple trait selection decisions. If we just use the EPDs by themselves, we have a tendency to use those EPDs in ways that are inconsistent and potentially ways that also double count certain traits. The selection index allows us to be consistent and to properly account for each trait in our overall goal of improving the profitability of animals. Part of that has then led to the revision of the way breed associations calculate some EPDs. For instance, we've integrated ultrasound data and carcass data to provide us single EPDs for carcass traits, like ribeye area, marbling. We've also integrated in the same process some of the modern day genomic tools so that we don't have a genomic EBV or EPD separate from the EPD that the breed association publishes based on the traits themselves.
Okay, great. And now we talk about, in the genetic field, we talk about genomic sequencing. And if you could talk a little bit about where you see us going forward in genetic selection with the new genomic sequencing.
So I think the sequence provides us a tremendous tool to be able to incorporate gene-level information into our selection decisions. I think that's going to be done in concert with the EPDs, the traditional EPDs, based on the measurement of traits. And I think the two together make a very powerful package for breeders to be able to advance their own goals in selection. Using either one separately is going to be less efficient than using the two together. And in fact, I think one of the things that's important for us to do is to encourage breeders to continue to measure the traits of economic importance.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. MacNeil, for being one of our speakers. For more information on the Genetic SDSU Extension Symposium, please go to www.igrow.org.